नेक्स्ट पार्ट इज़ द कैपिलैरिटी इन सॉइल्स. सो वाटर विच इज़ देयर इन सॉइल्स, इट इज़ हेल्ड इन टू सेट्स. फर्स्ट इज़ द ग्रेविटेशनल वाटर एंड सेकेंड इज़ द कैपिलरी वाटर. सो इफ देयर इज़ अ सॉइल मास एंड वाटर टेबल इज़ हियर, सो बिलो द वाटर टेबल द वाटर विल एग्जिस्ट इन द सॉइल ड्यू टू द फोर्स ऑफ ग्रेविटी. सो दिस वाटर इज नोन एज द ग्रेविटेशनल वाटर और इट इज़ ऑल्सो नोन एज द फ्रियटिक वाटर बिकॉज द टॉप सर्फेस ऑफ दिस वाटर टेबल इट इज़ सब्जेक्ट टू एटमोस्फेरिक प्रेशर. एंड बिलो दिस इन दिस जोन एट एनी पॉइंट द प्रेशर विल बी हाइड्रोस्टैटिक. But if it was the only force which was there in the soil, then the soil above this water will remain dry. But it is not the case. The water rises up to some distance above the water table, and that happens due to the capillary phenomenon. So the water will again be saturated up to a distance above the water table, and some more distance it will be partially saturated. So this zone above the water table it occurs due to the capillarity in soil, and the force which is responsible for holding the soil up above the distance from the water table it is the surface tension. So surface tension acts when the soil particle or any material it exists at the interface of two physical states. So here the soil is in contact with water and above the water table it comes into the contact with air. So at the interface of these two states the surface tension will take place, and because of that surface tension the water will rise up to a certain distance. And that rise is called the capillary rise. And so in this zone the water is in compression zone, and this water is going up due to the surface tension. So it is held up by suction, and so this water is in tension. And so above the water level the water is in tension, and below the water level it is in compression. So the hydrostatic condition will not exist in the capillary zone, and it can be understood by the glass tube experiment in water. So when a glass tube is inserted in water, the water rises up to certain distance because of the surface tension. And so if you want to find out the rise in water, so it is given as we can calculate by equating this surface tension force to the weight of the water in this column. So weight of the water in the column will be h into pi by 4 d square into gamma w, which is equal to the component of the surface tension force in the vertical direction. So from here hc is equal to 4 t upon gamma w into d if cos alpha is almost equal to 1. So this, using this formula, some relationships, empirical relationships are there for soil. So for silt and sand, one empirical relationship is h is equal to 0.03 where 0.2 by d10, where d10 is the effective size of the sand or silt. And similarly one more empirical formula, it is in centimeter. In this it is in meter, and this will be in mm. So here it is given as E times d10, where C is the empirical constraint. and its value lies between 1 to 0.5 centimeter square. And so from here, what is the main point to be understood is that the capillary rise will not depend upon the does not depend upon the grain size, but it depends upon the pore size. So if two soils which are having same effective size of the particles, they may have different capillary rise because of having different pore sizes. So the water which is there in the capillary zone, it is in tension, as I said. So if it is the water, in this zone it is in compression, let's say this is H, and so the pore water pressure we used to write for the below the water table, it is given as gamma W times H. But in the capillary zone, because in this zone water is in tension, and because we are considering compression as positive, so the tension will be negative. And so the in the capillary zone, if this is height is H dash, so at this point we find out the pore water pressure in the capillary zone with respect to this water table. So we go above from the water table, and this water will not be in hydrostatic condition. So in this zone the pore water pressure is given as minus gamma W times H dash. So the pore water pressure is negative, and we know that the effective stress is given as the total stress minus pore water pressure. So because pore water pressure is negative, so effective stress becomes sigma plus U. So the effective stress increases due to capillary water or capillary action. And because effective stress increases, so shear strength also increases. So there are some practical examples where the capillarity comes in use, that when some excavation is to be done in sand or silt, so that excavation can be done without providing any support. So on this side we need not provide any support if there is capillary water. So the water will hold, the soil will hold its position because of the increased shear strength. And another use is, or another place where it happens, that when because of this capillary water, so between the soil particles or the sand particles, this menisci takes place, and because of that apparent cohesion is there, and so these particles will stick to each other, and this phenomena is called as the soil suction. So because of that, bulking of sand takes place. Bulking of sand means the increase in the volume of sand. So when soil is poured on the ground, or it is put on the ground in the loose state, so these particles will not come closer to each other, so honeycomb structure will form in between them, because these particles can hold each other because of this capillary water. So they will hold each other, and now if this soil is, some water is applied on this soil, some more water is applied, so because of that these menisci will be broken, and the sudden volume change will take place. So this volume increase in volume phenomena is called as the bulking of the sand. So till now we saw that we are more interested in finding out the effective stress of the soil rather than the total stress. So it is because that effective stress controls the various soil parameters such as compressibility, shear strength, and other things such as bearing capacity. So direct relation is there between these parameters and the effective stress rather than the total stress. So we cannot relate these things with directly with the total stress, but they are well correlated with the effective stress. So we are always more interested in finding out the effective stress on the soil.